Hello, and welcome to the last day of Windows Azure Week. I am Miranda Luna, and I'm a product manager on the mobile workload team.
My name is Elio DiMaggio. I'm a PM on the Windows Azure mobile team.
So you've learned a lot about Azure this week. Today, what we're going to do is we're going to focus specifically on the services within Windows Azure that help with mobile app development, machine-to-machine, and Internet of Things. We're going to start by going over Notification Hubs, which is a service that is really easy to hook into any application you have already. So we wanted to kind of start with something that you could take and apply to what you have today. And then after that, what we're going to do is we're going to focus on how to actually build scalable mobile applications for both consumers and in the enterprise. And then we'll close out by looking at some connected devices scenarios and machine-to-machine command control type things. So let's get started. Today, what we're going to cover is give a little overview of Notification Hubs and where it kind of lives in the Azure universe. We're going to give you a good solid understanding of what mobile backends in Windows Azure means. And then we're going to move on to how to actually register an application you have today with Notification Hubs, the service. And Elio's going to give us a great little demo there. And then we're going to move on to how you would actually register devices for personalization with Notification Hubs. And then we'll get into the different push scenarios you might encounter, give you a couple snippets. And we'll end by looking at location-based push notifications and cover some best practices and resources. So just to set expectations a little bit, this is really going to be geared towards developers building mobile applications. You know, it doesn't matter what platform, Windows, iOS, Android, what kind of backend. Notification Hubs works with one on-prem, one in Azure, written in Java, .NET, Node, whatever you want. So we're going to cover all that, but anyone looking to build mobile applications or that has one already, this is going to be really relevant for. And I've included some links to supporting material that you're welcome to look at later on. Basically just introduction, kind of the broadcast scenario, and then also how to do some filtering. Just a friendly reminder to join the Microsoft Virtual Academy community. Definitely a very active community of over a million registered users, and somewhere you can go to get great content, like the Azure Week content, and also to kind of interact with other people who are working on similar things. So to go into an overview, mobile backends in Azure are basically pretty flexible. You're going to be able to build a mobile backend using any of the four compute models in Azure. You know, anything from virtual machines, Windows or Linux, to cloud services, which is web and worker roles. Web roles just being worker roles that have IIS installed on them already, so better for web-facing work. And then Windows Azure websites, and then finally mobile services. And if you take a look at this graphic, what you'll see is that you're kind of having a trade-off between the degree of customizability and speed of development and ease of maintenance. As you go along that line, you know, the closer you are to the metal with virtual machines, you have all that control. You can control which OS patches you're going to make and when. You're going to control everything from the metal up. Whereas, you know, as you kind of move over to the right, you're going to give up some of that control, but you're going to get quicker development time. You know, with web and worker roles, we're going to patch the OS for you. With websites, you know, we're going to give you an environment tailored for the exact type of application you're looking for. With mobile services, we're going to give you helpers that are specific to that mobile vertical, especially around authentication, push notifications, storage, and logic. So now, Notification Hubs, which is what we're going to be talking about during this session, hooks into any of those backends, into any of those backend hosted in any of those four Windows Azure compute models we talked about, as you can see on the right-hand side. But it also hooks into any backend you might have hosted on-premises. You don't have to adjust your firewall. You don't have to use Service Bus Relay. It's a really easy way to hook into a workload you might already have created, and it's really no code rewrite on your part. We're going to cover kind of what some of the benefits are later on, but as you can see, it's really going to be flexible, and this is why it's so relevant to kind of cover this first off as a level set, because this isn't the application creation point. It's really enhancing what you already have. So when you look at mobile push notifications, this is a new form of interacting with users that was introduced with mobile applications and smartphones. You know, they're essential in applications in everything from consumer applications where you're saving money because they're thousands of times cheaper than SMS, and enterprise applications where you're really kind of making sure you ping your employees when you need to get their attention. It's not an email that might go unread. And it's not just, you know, alerts and toasts and tiles, you know, the little red buttons you see, the charms that come in when you get a new email. It's also, you know, push to sync notifications to make sure that your data is as up to date as possible and that the information your user or your employee is seeing is as relevant and up to date as can be. So as you can see, you know, we talked a little bit about people, customers with different backends and whether they're hosted in virtual machines or on-premises or all the way down to mobile services. We have customers today who are in production using notification hubs with backends across every, they run the whole gambit. You know, made from a major media publisher in the APAC region who has a backend hosted on-premises in ASP.NET MVC, all the way to, you know, someone who's hosted in websites and, you know, Oz Postcards, which is hosted in mobile services and uses notification hubs in conjunction to really hit that scale targeted push scenario. So before we jump into exactly what notification hubs is and what sort of benefit you're going to get from using it, Elio and I thought it would be good to cover a little bit about what challenges push notifications present, because they are kind of unique to someone who might have more experience in a web-based world. So there's a few things to keep in mind when you're thinking about challenges with push notifications. When you're rolling your own push, you're going to have to think about cross-platform. You know, the different client platforms, Windows, Android, iOS, they all have different platform push notification services. And each of those have different protocols, they handle different payloads, and that's a lot of logic and routing and that you have to handle on your app's backend, especially if you're going to be adding platforms later. You know, something that might be really efficient for targeting a single client platform is going to be a little more unwieldy if you try to keep that same structure when you target a second or third or fourth platform. The other thing you got to keep in mind is that you're going to need to be targeting based on interest and location if you really want to make sure you're giving your customer or your employee the relevant notifications. So in addition to kind of having to build in logic to work with the different platform push notification services, you're going to have to also build in a way to maintain a registration table and different interest tags for different users and think about how that needs to grow as you add additional fields that you might want to segment based on. So if you were only thinking, okay, I need to know gender, location, and one favorite item, that's fine, but if you already have 2 million users and then you go to add more fields, you're going to have a lot of null values. So that's something to keep in mind. And then, of course, you know, that's kind of more on the server side, but if you think about the client side, you're going to have customers probably with different languages and devices, and you have to think about, you know, is it efficient for me to send different push notifications, make different API calls from my app backend and send different notifications and messages with different language information and different formatted for different devices? Or is there a better way where I could maybe send a single notification or a single message that contains all the relevant information and then have a filter applied on the client side? The fourth challenge is probably the biggest one. High volume with low latency is incredibly difficult to accomplish. So, you know, when you think about kind of how many push notifications you can send from your app backend, you're limited by the power of the underlying compute. So you're probably, if there's a breaking news scenario or you want to send a lot all at once, you're going to need to have a lot of virtual machines provisioned. So you might think, okay, well, I'm going to go with small virtual machine instances. I'm going to have them sitting idle and then I'll scale slowly so that, you know, I'm being very efficient. I'm not wasting any money on too many idle machines, but that's going to take you a lot longer to kind of scale that out. And you're going to need a lot more of them once you do need to send that notification out to everybody at once. And then, of course, if you're like, well, I want to be able to send a notification to everybody quickly, immediately, if that happens, think about any sort of news application, you know, or if score app, you know, Super Bowl is coming up, you wouldn't want to be telling someone about a touchdown 20 minutes after it happened. Then you'd have to provision a lot of larger virtual machines, and that's going to be more expensive if you're not using them. Then lastly, the device handle registry. You know, it's always important to remember that these platform push notification services will kind of suspend your privileges to use them if you are not maintaining an active device handle registry. So that means if you're sending push notifications to phones and tablets that have already uninstalled your application, that's not something that Microsoft or Apple or Google takes very kindly to, just because it is resource constrained in terms of what they can provide to their developers. So, getting to the good stuff. This is a quick overview of what you're getting in notification hubs, which is that service that hooks into any app backend, on-prem or in the cloud. So if you kind of take a look, we'll go left to right, you'll see that there's a single message being sent to the notification hub and that there are three different tags associated with that message. So there's a tag for female, Seattle, and vanilla. Only the device handles that have those three tags associated with them, if we did say use the Boolean expression with it, are going to receive that message. You'll see that, you know, as the notification hub, which maintains the device registry, kind of filters, that APNS, which is the iOS platform push notification service, isn't even receiving a message from notification hubs. It's really only going to be the devices that have those three tags. And if you go all the way to the right, what you'll see is that, you know, the message is actually getting displayed differently on each device. You'll see dollars, you'll see yen, you'll see pounds. But there was only ever a single message sent. So what's actually happening is you're packaging all the information that every user could need based on localization in that single message. And then on the client side, there is what we call a template applied that's going to only show the relevant information based on what that device registered for in terms of a template when they installed the app. And we're going to show you how to do all this. But the key takeaways here are really that Notification Hubs is an incredibly scalable service. So you're never going to have to think about provisioning virtual machines sending notifications to every user at once. You're never going to have to think about, you know, have I provisioned too much or too little resources. We're going to handle all the tags that you need as long as you specify them. So we're going to make sure that the right content gets to the right users. And we're going to let you do it all in a single API call, even if you want to send it into different localized versions based on currency, based on preference for metric system, based on language. So with that, let us move on to the next module. In module 2, we're going to be covering app registration, which is how you're actually going to set up your existing app backend to communicate with notification hubs. So this is the point where you're going to be setting it up so that if you're sending an API call from your application backend, it's going to actually get to the notification hub hosted in Windows Azure. And from there, all the push notifications will be sent out. So with that, I hand it over to my good friend Elio to walk us through it.
Okay, so basically what we're going to do, we're going to start with the Windows Azure portal and provision a notification hub. Then we'll see how we can very, very easily set up a Windows Store application to use that notification hub in order to receive push notifications. So let's look at the portal. This is the Windows Azure portal. In here, I have a whole bunch of items. Inside Service Bus, you can basically create a notification hub by going in App Services, Service Bus, and then Notification Hub, and doing quick create. I already created many of those that I can see here under Notification Hubs. And I'm going to use a hub that is called Demo Hub. In here, you will be able to see many things, statistics, lots of the statistics under the monitoring tab. You're going to be able to scale. This is like the scaling part. And and you're going to be able to configure this, to configure the hub to push notifications.
Oh, yeah, maybe could we stretch that out a little bit bigger, make it full frame so we can make sure everybody can see it?
Okay.
Awesome.
This has already been configured with my app. These credentials are not anything special, so it's not a real app.
So now, Ilio, are those Windows notification settings, that's what you're actually getting from WNS, which
that is
correct. The Windows Platform Push Notification Service.
That is correct. So basically, when you register your Windows Store application to the Windows Store, you're going to receive those credentials back, and you can use them to push notifications. They're also used to perform Windows Live authentication, but in this case, we're gonna use only for push notifications. Then we're gonna start from a complete blank project. So I am gonna take here Windows Visual Studio 2013. I'm gonna create a new Windows Store app, just a blank app, and now. The first thing that I want to do is to associate this app with my app in the store. So inside store, I will associate my app with the store. And in here, I have to put in my credentials. Okay. and a password. Okay, and in here I will have. I cannot really do this. Okay.
Why don't you send it to your phone or check it on your phone? We can continue with the demo, but no problem.
Oh, what I can do is that I can show an app that is already
Great.
Configured with
awesome.
That. So what we're gonna do? We're gonna just open an app that I already have there. Okay. Okay, so this app has already been associated with the store, and what I'm doing here.
So with that flow of just taking you through kind of entering your credentials as a Windows
correct.
Developer,
that
gotten
correct.
That, packaged it into this Visual Studio project.
That is correct.
Great.
The only thing that it does is it's just that in here inside my manifest, it fills this packaging information. The other thing that I want to do is that I want to allow the toast notifications. Mm-hmm. Then another thing that I'm doing is that I added the service bus NuGet package. So from here, from NuGet, you just look for notification hubs, and you're going to see here the managed library that I have to put mm-hmm. for this specific app. Then what I'm going to do is that I'm going to in my app mm-hmm. I create an instance of the notification hub, and every time it starts,
yep.
I have to make sure to register this particular device.
Gotcha.
So at the end of launching, what I'm doing is that I'm creating an instance of mm-hmm. this notification hub.
Yep.
Notice here the credentials, this big connection string. It's something that you pick up from the portal.
Great.
And then
and that's going to be unique to your application.
Then it's going to be
yep.
unique to your application. And then in this init notifications, the mm-hmm. only thing that you're going to do, you're going to get a channel from the notification channel and mm-hmm. then register for through
Great.
The notification hub. Once you have this done, we can start this app
mm-hmm.
and what it's going to do, we're going to see that that the breakpoint is going to work. We have here the channel.
Yep.
And in this case, we're going to register a specific template. We're going to go more in detail of
Great.
What that means. This is an optional step. And in this case, we're going to go to the hub and mm-hmm. register this device. Once
okay.
this is done, we can basically send push notifications. You can test it very quickly from the portal mm-hmm. inside the debug. We're going to send a custom message. And in here, we're just saying notification hub test notification.
Yep.
If everything
fingers
works, hopefully it works. And here is
there
the notification
it is. Awesome.
Coming up.
So now, Elio, on when you did that registration, was that also kind of creating the device registry within Notification Hubs that's going to maintain all this information?
That is correct. So one of the main value proposition of Notification Hubs is that it handles all your channel URIs, all your device tokens, and all your registration IDs for mm-hmm. GCM. That is basically, it feels like a big registry. It associates all the tags and interest groups for the specific device.
Mm-hmm.
And that is very important. And sometimes it's a challenge that that is unexpected, because it seems like just a big table with handles, but there's lots of logic that has to happen in order not to be blacklisted from the platform notification services, in order to make sure that everything is handled properly, things are expired when they have to, mm-hmm. and all these things. So that is the motion, the simple motion that basically triggers all that
yeah.
value.
And much better to never run into those problems or have to think about
them.
Fantastic. And for those who are following online and who are going to be looking at this deck later, we did include those code snippets for registering an iOS, Android, or Windows app. You're welcome to grab those from the slides or the Notification Hub's Documentation Center. Moving on to the third module, we kind of showed how to register your application. We went from a Visual Studio blank application and added notification hubs. and a Windows Store WNS credentials. What we need to do now, though, is also think about how to actually register devices and what that means in terms of tags and templates. Remember, tags are what you're going to apply on the server side. Those are interest groups. Those are when you want to send segmented push notifications with different content to different people. Templates are on the client side, and those are going to be applied to a message you want everybody to get, but that you want to personalize or localize based on device, language, currency, things like that. So to quickly pull this up, unexpected build. Those are always fun. So when you're looking at templates for cross-platform push notifications, think about them on the client side. You know, think about different Android devices that you might be formatting a notification for. Think about somebody who might want to see currency displayed in pound versus US dollar. Think about someone who might want to see Fahrenheit versus Celsius. All those preferences are created in a template that you apply on the actual device side. So you're not thinking about that from the server. When you're making an API call, you're not saying, hey, make sure that we target these types of templates with this message. That's not what you're doing. If that's what you're kind of thinking, then you want to make that a tag. So if you're thinking, well, I'm going to use currency as a proxy for user's location, probably wouldn't do that. But if that's what you were thinking, you know, you would want to make a tag for that too, because you can't send to template. Template is applied after the message already reaches the device. It's not going to segment who's actually getting it. Elio, is there anything you wanted to point out here?
Basically, the templates makes really, really easy to do cross-platform things. And it's really one of the other challenges that arrives like late in the implementation of push notifications. One starts with Apple, then you have to add Android, then you have to add Windows or any order. Right. And they seem very similar, but the differences starts like creeping into your code. This starts basically complicating your backend a lot.
Yeah.
And with this, with templates, you can really, really achieve a nice separations between the client presentation, so localization and user preferences like currencies and metrics that makes it really, really easy.
And it's also an efficiency thing too, right? So you're not sending multiple messages. I could just imagine, you know, without a service like Notification Hubs, what you're going to end up doing is you're going to end up sending different messages every time you want to send to different interest groups. But then within each of those messages, you're sending different ones for different client platforms because they all have to be formatted differently. A tile is not a toast. A toast is not an Android display notification. And then when you think about the different devices too, and then also you think about the different client preferences, especially in terms of language and localization, it gets unwieldy really fast and inefficient in terms of what you're doing with your app backend.
That is correct, especially if you have to target a very large number of devices. If you're sending multiple notifications, even if each of those targets multiple devices, you're still sending multiple different messages. So the notification hub cannot really take advantage of the full scale. So if you want to hit like let's say a million devices and you're sending a notification hub like 20 different versions, notification hub cannot really optimize that thing properly. So you can go a lot faster by basically packaging everything in one single conceptual message and then use templates to perform the localization and the cross-platform versions of those notifications.
Definitely. So we talked a little bit about templates for personalization and localization. So we can move on from this. We definitely want to include it for those of you who are reviewing the slides at home. But I want to make sure that we have time to, well, I do want to flag template expressions just because, you know, you can think about, you're not just, again, like the packaging. The Notification Hubs is all about efficiency and doing things once instead of 19 or 20 or 100 times. You're packaging templates and as Boolean expressions of multiple personalization pieces. So you're not having to have separate templates for everything. It's a combination of the user preferences. So what we're going to do is kind of show you what it means to set up these cross-platform templates and tags. Again, tags being interest groups on the server side. So, you know, anything that if you're like, I want to push only the Seattle Seahawks fans, versus the Denver Broncos fans. You probably don't want to get those two mixed up. So you would want different message content going to those based on the teams they follow. Whereas, you know, on the, again, on the device side, it's not wanting to try to send a toast notification to an iPhone. So let's get started and do a little bit more demo.
Yes. So let's look here at this specific app. This is basically the Windows Store app that is registering for native notification. So basically not for a template. What this means is that when we send a message, and in here I do have the piece of C-sharp code that is sending a message, I'm sending this specific payload, a toast for a Windows Store application. People that are send this, that have seen like push notifications for Windows will recognize this XML as the XML that you have to send to display a toast notification. And then we can just use the hub and send this native notification. This is actually a broadcast, so you do not have to do the fan out on your own in your backend. So there's already a huge value proposition here. However, when you start adding multiple platform, and here I have Windows Phone, for instance. So let's assume that I have, and we will see it, we have like one Windows Phone app that is basically the same getting started that's in Windows Azure. And you see that in your backend, you start having to maintain all these different payloads. Mm-hmm. If we had an Android version and an Apple version, I would have four different versions of the payloads, four different sends. and that's not considering like doing localizations and all this sort of thing. So this code can quickly become unwieldy.
Yep.
Now, what we're going to do, we're basically just going to put everything on its head. So we're going to take this template and we're going to make sure that each app knows, is declaring what kind of format it wants to receive. So let's take this specific string, which is in this case my hello from .NET toast message, and I'm gonna go in my Windows Store app. This is my Windows Store app, and instead of registering a native, instead of creating like a native registration, what I'm gonna do, I'm going to create a template string. And instead of the message, I'm actually gonna use an expression. So in here, I want to say, hey, this is not the string that I want to display. Yep. I want to display something that's coming inside of hub as a property called message.
Yep.
And of course, for the template expressions that you were talking about, this is where you put it. If you want to put some literals, if you want to combine multiple properties, and if you want to pick like the message in English or in French, this is how you do localization. And then, instead of doing register native, we actually use register template async. We use the channel URI, we provide the template, and then we have to provide a template name. This is because you can actually register for multiple templates.
Absolutely. That was the expressions we saw earlier, right? You know, expressions and tags and templates letting you combine using any Boolean expression and not or going crazy.
That is correct. This is a toast template.
Great.
So, which means that if I want to receive tiles, I can create another template, and so on and so forth. Now, this is this client, but I also had a Windows Phone client. Mm-hmm. So let's go here and say, well, I actually need to make sure that my Windows Phone is registering for this specific XML.
Yep.
So I'm going in my Windows Phone app. This is the same. This is basically the same getting started app. So here when I'm launching, I'm just getting the channel and registering with the hub with my specific channel URI. In here, I'm gonna create my template. Again, I want to make sure that instead of a string, I'm actually using here a specific property from the message.
Right. And this being whatever message you send from your application backend.
That is correct.
Every time you want to send a push.
That is correct.
Yep.
That is correct. So basically, and again, instead of doing register native, I'm gonna register for a template, and I'm gonna have my channel, I'm gonna have my template, and I'm gonna name the template toast template. Same thing I will have to do in case MPNS is a little harder to configure, but it's the exact same method. Mm-hmm. I just have like two places where I have to call it. Again, my channel,
yep.
my template, and my template name. Okay, now basically I told my two apps how they want to receive the notifications, and they both expect a property called message.
Yep.
How do I send this specific property? Mm-hmm. In here, all of this stuff basically goes away. I'm not sending a specific payload anymore.
Yep.
What I'm going to do, I'm going to send one single template notification.
Yep.
And one template notifications, you see here, there is a dictionary. Maybe it's a little bit too small, but effectively is a new dictionary. And I'm going to have one property. Sorry.
Oh, no.
I'm going to have one property that is called message, because basically this is the property that my clients are expected.
And again, if you were going to put different languages, this is where you would put it, because that template will be applied once it reaches the device.
That is correct. So I could have here one property called message English, message French, message Chinese, message Japanese, and so
on. Perfect.
And you see here how my code on the back end is really, really simplified.
Yeah.
And adding,
that was only for two platforms.
This same code would work if you want to add like an iOS, if you want to app, if an Android client. Your backend is completely agnostic. Mm-hmm. That is great when you're when you have like multiple teams that are working on the same app.
Yep.
Very often you have like a backend team and a client team, and this makes it really, really easy to do that. Now let's see this work.
All right.
Inside. inside the app. Now we have to register. Mm-hmm. We're starting this app. We see here that we get the channel, we instantiate the template, and we register the template with Notification Hub. Mm-hmm. This is done. This specific app has been registered. The same thing has to happen for Windows Phone. This will take a little bit more time because I have to start the emulator. But basically what is going to happen is the exact same thing. Mm-hmm. We're going to
receive that notification.
We're going to first register.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
And then when we, okay.
Oh, nice.
This is starting.
Now we're showing all of this in Visual Studio and C Sharp, but if someone had a backend, they wanted to write Node or PHP, if they were on Linux box, like they're fine. Whatever they want.
That is true. The great thing is that you can send a notification from any backend.
Mm-hmm.
We do have like a public REST API.
Sure.
We have wrappers for Node. We have wrapper for C Sharp, like we're using here. We you can use it really, really easily from mobile services.
Yep.
And here we see we're registering the template. Now, here we go here. And then when we send a notification from our backend, which in this case is just a very, very simple, sorry, here I have actually to put a wait. This is an async method. You either have to wait, this would not make it work. Okay. So once I run this console app, which can be like my own prem and all these things, what is going to happen is that I'm going to see one.
There you go.
There's one here, but there's also
one on your
one on the phone.
Perfect. Hello from a template notification.
Exactly.
Perfect. Wow.
Exactly.
This
is basically how to do cross-platform with template, and you see that it was basically mostly putting everything on its head. You do not have to send all the different payloads. You just basically use them to register, and that makes it the backend completely platform agnostic.
Now we have a lot of customers using this in production today. How much would you say they've said this cuts down on their development time and their maintenance, especially going forward as they kind of expand and reach other platforms?
Yeah, our largest user right now for templates is the Winter Olympics app. Actually, the Winter Olympics app, which is starting in I think a week, is gonna use a notification hub for push notifications, and they use templates for localization, like we said, and also for personalization of units of measures, so Celsius and Fahrenheit, degrees, meters, and yards, and these things that really brought down like their costs a lot.
Great. So, moving on to our fourth module, we demoed showing sending a push notification, but we're going to kind of talk through some different scenarios that you might come across. You know, sending to a single logical user, sending to a group of users, or broadcasting to everybody, and kind of talk through the benefits at each stage that you get with notification hubs. So, if you're going to represent a single logical user, you know, a tag can use to be represent that with a user ID. You can name it whatever you'd like, but basically the client app is going to authenticate with the back end, and then the device handle is going to also pass to the back end. Once the app back end is registered, then there's the tag created called user ID, and then you can target the individual users by when you're sending that message saying particular user ID equals. Here you see that when it's 00430924, a message that is sent with that tag is only going to reach that device. It won't reach that tablet device next to it because it has a different user ID. So for scenarios where you're kind of inboxing notifications, where you really want to, maybe it's a chat app or you have something where you just want to send push notifications to a single logical user every time there's a game update and one they're involved in, any of those high volume inbox scenarios, that's kind of one way you could definitely think about doing it. It's easier to kind of take that logic that you already have in your backend because it understands a single logical user, apply a unique value, and then pass that along to your notification hub. For broadcasting to a segment based on interest, this is something Elio and I spoke about, and he demoed really well. But we want to point out that, you know, you tag expressions is a really powerful tool. It lets you send a notification based to very segmented groups of users using any Boolean expression. So if you want to send to just Beatles fans or just Rolling Stones fans, you can. Or if you want to send to someone who's a Beatles fan but not a Rolling Stones fan, you can. Or if you want to send to everybody who's not a Rolling Stones or a Beatles fan, you can do that as well. And this was a recent update we released. It was really kind of made things go a lot smoother for customers so that they were, again, building on that efficiency that we always want to try to deliver in terms of what you can do with a single call instead of having to make multiple ones and, you know, kind of make more requests on the back end.
Yeah, and for tag expressions, one of the main scenarios is, of course, like segmentations, like mm-hmm. people that have like this interest and that other interest. But there are many other use cases. For instance, you can have a tag that is your time zone, and then you can basically make sure that you're not
waking anyone up in the middle of the night.
Waking everybody up in the middle of the night, for instance. you can basically use tags to represent different platforms or client versions, so to make sure to have like different to send different messages or not to send messages that certain client versions are not able to handle.
Yeah.
In this case, we're talking about push notifications are directed at the app, so they
yep.
might have like some special data. So tag expressions is actually much more powerful than just segmentation. Segmentation is a great use case, but yep. there are many other things that you might find this feature useful for.
And that's where it comes down to talking about tags and templates again, right? Like when you want to use those tags when you don't want certain messages to get to certain devices. So like you said, devices that might not be able to handle a given push notification, you never want it to get there. So it doesn't matter what the template is on the client side because it should never be reaching that
Correct.
Device. so that's when you would use tags is to make sure that the right messages are getting to the right people. Again, based on time zone, which is a really powerful thing, especially if you have a massive consumer-facing application. And then think about templates. Only once the message gets there, you want to make sure they see it the right way. And then, you know, one of the most powerful things we see in notification hubs that we get from our customers is that, you know, that power to broadcast to everybody at once. You know, some of the challenges associated with that at scale are just kind of massive, right? Because push notifications is a very variable use of compute. If you're not sending a push notification, you don't need all those resources provisioned. So being able to essentially rent them from a service like Notification Hubs has really been a game changer for a lot of customers, hasn't it?
Yeah, this is true. So when you're broadcasting to millions of devices and you want to do that in a short time frame, and by short time frame, I mean like less than 20 minutes.
Right.
And any push notifications that actually has like a latency of more than 30 minutes, it doesn't really have a reason to exist, because you can do everything else just by polling a website.
Yep.
So if you want to push notifications, you actually want that information freshness. Mm-hmm. So if you want to do that, you basically have to use lots of virtual machines that are sending these one-to-one notifications to the platform, the notification services. Mm-hmm. And until now, we did talk to a lot of challenges that are more regarding like code maintenance and features and these sort of things. But this is a real deployment cost saver. The thing is that what happens is that you when the broadcast is kicked off, mm-hmm. you have to have lots of VMs ready to go.
Right.
And you do not have the time to spun those out that make you like lose like another like 5 minutes just to have all these VMs ready to go.
Exactly.
And then they can start. So what we do is that we make sure that we have all those VMs ready for you, and mm-hmm. you're not paying them unless you're pushing notifications.
Yep. Which is great, because then your app backend is really only tailored for what the users need and kind of what's based on your traffic, instead of this highly variable need based on push notifications and getting that low latency, which I think is fantastic. That does bring up a good point, though, about notifying users in batches. You know, not just in what we talked about in terms of different time zones, so maybe wanting to use tags in order to send batches, but also we just talked about kind of how your app backend, this is great because you don't have to scale it up or out necessarily to send push notifications at scale. But one thing to think about is that, you know, if you have a particular action in that push notification and every 15 million people ping your app at the same time, that might be a lot more concurrent users than you had in mind and that you had resources provisioned for on the back end. So we found that some customers really want to make sure that they have an ability to send to limited batches of users at once so that the back end's not getting overwhelmed. Is there anything in particular you wanted to point out there? It's pretty much based on batch numbers is based on user preference. We've seen different batches from customers, you know, anything from couple million devices to a couple hundred thousand to a couple thousand devices, just because, you know, they want to test out what their system can handle, but they also want to make sure that they're getting the notifications out as quickly as possible.
That is true. This basically is one specific case of like a special use of tag expressions, mm-hmm. because effectively what we're doing here is that we're using a specific tag, so batch ID, mm-hmm. To identify like smaller audiences. So you're just saying broadcast to everybody that follows a specific, I don't know, like Beatles we're talking about. So Beatles and batch one, Beatles and batch two. There are like many, this is basically a very, very useful case of use of the tag expression feature, which is really great because it was pointed to us by one of our customers that actually found this use.
So in section 5, we want to kind of dive deeper a little into a particular scenario, which is location-based push. Obviously, geofencing, something that's on everybody's mind in terms of making sure they're getting the right content to the right user at the right time, which is much easier said than done. We don't have time for the full demo, but we will point you to where you can kind of get a full end-to-end overview of it, and we're going to walk you through some of the high-level points. So this is just kind of setting a little bit of expectations in terms of what you look at when you're looking at geotargeting. It's always a trade-off between temporal accuracy and geographical accuracy, and different apps have different needs, right? So if you're sending a contextual reminder, it's going to really matter where the location, because you need to know within 300 feet of my store and within a couple minutes of them driving by, I want them to know that they should be taking a particular action. You know, I don't want them to be getting a notification when there are 5 exits down the highway. Or even if it's kind of a local downtown area, you know, I want to hit them with a notification when they're coming up on an ice cream shop. I don't want them to be already down at dinner. So it's very important to get it to them at a specific location, at a specific time. But then, you know, that kind of goes all the way down the spectrum, down to where, you know, it doesn't really matter how quickly the notification gets there, but or exactly how tight that that geofence is. You're kind of thinking about coupons and regions, right? So, you know, getting a coupon today versus tomorrow isn't a huge deal always, but you do want to think about, you know, people's schedules, right? So if you're sending a notification to them about a coupon for this weekend, great. Thursday, Wednesday, Friday, doesn't really matter as much. But if you're needing to get that out right away, that need might change. And that's, again, where you know notification hubs and having a designated push service really gives you the flexibility in planning and scheduling and the ability to be more agile and respond to your customers. Do you want to talk us through this, Elio?
Yes. So basically here we see basic pattern on how to perform this last scenario. The idea is basically to use a reverse geocoding service. Bing has one, Google mm-hmm. has one, Yahoo has one.
Yep.
What they do is that they take some latitude longitude coordinates and tell you basically the zip code, the mm-hmm. address, the country, and so on. Most of the time, that's the kind of accuracy that you need. You do not need anything more than that.
Right.
You just want to know city, you want to know like metropolitan area, and that's about it. So if that is the case, the thing, like a very, very easy way to do it is basically to get the specific information. So the city level, at mm-hmm. the zip level, zip is like the postal code for
sure.
people that do not live in the US. So postal code, and then encode it in a tag. Then once you have this information inside tags, you can use tag expressions mm-hmm. to target those people. As far as the temporal accuracy go, the thing is that you can just assume that you can basically run this scheduled job once every day. Mm-hmm. This is also one has to be cognizant of the battery power of the mobile devices. So something that is very, very easily done like once a day. Even like less frequently than that, how many people change like state or like region?
Sure.
More often than that, it can happen, but
yeah.
But this thing is how you can use tags in a very easy way to perform location targeted push. It's really a matter of using standard reverse geocoding libraries that are available on all the platforms, and then basically encode the location that you want mm-hmm. in a tag.
And you bring up a really important point in terms of being respectful of users' battery life. And this is a really good way to manage it using tag expressions, because so often people will just have an application that's constantly pinging the location, and that'll just drain battery, as anyone who's ever downloaded one of those apps can tell you. So in terms of doing it in a respectful way that's kind of giving the user the information they want without, you know, a ton of inconvenience in terms of losing ability to use their phone and also to interact and take the action you want potentially, this is a great way to kind of tackle that problem. And if you follow the link that's included in this PowerPoint presentation, you'll be able to see kind of what that looks like end to end. There's a great walkthrough available and code samples, of course. So to close out, what we want to make sure we cover is some best practices and point you in the direction of resources that could be helpful. So again, tags to define batches of devices. We talked through that scenario. You know, tag expressions, that's really powerful in terms of making sure that you're sending notifications in groups that your backend can handle if everybody takes the action you specify. Tags, of course, using to define logical users or groups that you want to that you actually want to receive the message content. So, you know, again, if you don't want a message to get to somebody, then you should be using tags to designate that. If you want the message to get there, but to maybe read out in different ways, that's when you use the templates. Can't emphasize it enough. There are definitely scenarios where you might want both, right? You might have a template based on device to format the appropriate dimensions and type, but you might also want a tag based on device so that, you know, you're not sending a certain message to an unsupported platform. Those are the sort of things you want to think through. And of course, with tag expressions, you can further segment. So, you know, only send to these devices that can receive this message, but then I also want to segment based on time of day, maybe their time zone. And then furthermore, now I want to actually get down to their interests and getting them the relevant content. If you're looking at more kind of advanced scenarios in terms of, you know, delivery acknowledgement, end-to-end encryption, auditing, that is possible today in conjunction with SignalR and other service bus features. And there are resources available where you can find samples for that. You know, there's push notifications definitely open up a whole new world, and it's beyond just the little ding and the toast notification or a tile flag. So think about kind of what you need in terms of communicating with your users, and then think about what the best tools you have at your disposal are. So, you know, Elio mentioned in geotagging the scheduled job feature. You know, we have the Windows Azure Scheduler, which kind of lets you invoke any HTTPS endpoint on whatever schedule you want. So kind of using these services in conjunction is a way to really take advantage of Windows Azure as a suite of services and not kind of standalone pick and choose. We really try to make it possible for you to accomplish pretty much anything that you need to within the platform. And this just kind of flags a couple customers that are in production today and happy. Big news, which is on every Windows device, and NBC News. You know, again, these two are news examples because we wanted to really emphasize just how important that low latency at scale is, and to kind of give you a sense of exactly what we're talking about. We're talking about every single Windows device with Bing News. That's a massive scale. Think about how many Windows 8 licenses have been sold. Bing News is installed on all of them. And being able to hit all those devices when breaking news happens, when an election result is in, when, you know, there's a weather warning, those sort of things, it's very important to get that information out in a timely manner. And when you think about, you know, again, how widespread Windows 8 is and the ability to serve those customers, it gives you an idea of kind of the scale we're talking about with notification hubs. Then, of course, this will be included in the deck, but if you want to look at resources, you know, we have great documentation center both within WindowsAzure.com, also on MSDN, great getting started content, and then, of course, Channel 9 videos that everybody knows and loves to kind of get more in-depth on different scenarios. So on behalf of Elio and I definitely wanted to say thank you for joining us today. I know it's been a long week about learning about Windows Azure, but we have a few more sessions to go. Hopefully starting out with showing you something you can build that you can add into your existing applications today will give you kind of a good sense of what's coming for the rest of the day. And we certainly hope that you join us for those. We're going to be building mobile applications for consumers and employees. And then we'll round out by looking at connected devices and M2M scenarios. But thank you so much for joining us today.